Let's say hi to Joe Rogan. Ooh. Joe, are you?
Hi, Joe.
Joe.
Did you just, morning, boys.
Did you stay up just to talk to us, or did you get some sleep?
I stayed up.
Nice.
Yeah, I really don't usually go to bed before 4 anyway, so.
Yeah.
Night owl, as they like to say, right?
Yes, a night owl.
Hey, highly intelligent person on the phone. I want your quick take on the whole Newtown thing, man.
Well, you know, obviously it's horrific and disgusting and scary, but what the big question that I want to know is what kind of medication was this kid on?
Yeah.
I think that's a big factor in a lot of these. It was a big factor in Columbine. I think it's a big factor in a lot of these terrifying situations. I think there's a lot of kids that are raised in this country on meds,
mm-hmm.
and we don't really know the full impact of these things. We also don't know what was wrong with him, what his home life was. It's a horrifying fucking situation, you know, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also incredibly tragic. There's nothing we could do once it's over that can make anybody feel any better, and everybody's scrambling for gun control, and everybody's scrambling to, you know, to figure out how to take assault weapons out of the picture. I don't know what the fuck.
I honestly don't think that's a solution. I mean, people are going to get their hands on these things and do bad things. And, you know, short of arming somebody in the school, I think protecting the kids, putting some kind of barrier between the kids and any shooter, much like in a bank, you know, there really isn't much you can do to try to keep these things out of bad and sick people's hands.
Yeah, the argument is that if he didn't have assault weapons, he wouldn't be able to do this as easy. And I see that argument.
Sure.
But also, there's another argument that a lot of people don't want to consider, but if this was a well-armed area, this guy would not have done that.
Right.
They don't do this. They don't go to military bases fully armed like this. They go where places where they know it's going to have an impact. People are going to be horrified, and they're going to be able to do it without the kind of resistance that they would get if they went where people are armed.
Yeah.
Joe, you're a dad. Would you feel more comfortable with the guns gone, or your daughter's going to school where there was somebody who's kind of, you know, a guard or something? What would make you feel more comfortable?
Well, the guns gone is unrealistic. It's like trying to take pee out of the ocean. At this point in time, how the fuck are you going to get rid of all the guns?
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of guns just at Anthony's house.
Yeah.
Talk about the rest of the fucking country.
Yes.
You know, and this guy, by the way, he violated a fuckload of laws before he ever even left the house.
Exactly.
They were his mother's guns, and you know, they should have been, for sure, they should have been locked up in some sort of a safe. You know, I'm all for responsible mm-hmm. gun ownership, but it's Timothy McVeigh killed a fuckload of people with a bunch of fertilizer and a truck.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, if people want to kill people, they can kill people. They can get away with it in a bunch of different ways. It's that the mindset to kill strangers just to be able to make the news, just to be able to make an impact.
Right.
That's what's fucked up.
People love asking, like, why is the United States different than France and Germany and England as far as these shootings go and these killings? We have this FASA fucking nation with celebrity in this country.
Yeah.
We love, everyone wants to be famous. And for a twisted individual, this is the way to do it. If you know you're going to be checking out, the best way to do it before you go to become famous is by doing this. We're fascinated with celebrity. It's more powerful than video games, than the availability of assault weapons. And I truly believe that's the difference between America and these other countries.
And Joe, I ask you, we were talking about this yesterday. When we were all growing up, we're all relatively the same age. You had these weird kids like this, these loners and whatnot. And they would just go in their basement and hang themselves, or you know, they would step in front of a train. What has changed? Do you think where now they want to go out in a blaze of glory?
I think meds have a lot to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the untold. Look, I lost a good friend, Phil Hartman, because his wife was on cocaine and Zoloft. You know, I think there's something happening when we're engineering the consciousness of our citizens.
Mm.
in a way that I don't think is really completely understood, especially for children. And they do it, like, really easily. I have a neighbor. They since moved out. But these people, their kids were normal kids, man. There was nothing fucked up about their kids. But they had these kids on Ritalin because they just didn't want a deal.
Yeah.
And
God.
Who knows what the fuck that's doing?
Right.
I don't know what happened.
I think kids are supposed to grow into their own. I mean, when I was in school, obviously you had the weirdo and the fucking guy that was a little too rambunctious, and maybe the kid that fell asleep in class. But I think it's part of what develops into your personality. You grow into it. You make relationships and change. This fascination with just drugging these kids to try to get them to assimilate to what we think they're supposed to be at that age is ridiculous. Instead of just the natural progression of growing, they figured just load them up with drugs and fucks these kids up.
I like Joe Rogan's take on it because we're all focusing on the guns, but I mean, legal drugs in this country is completely out of control. And that's obviously a huge business, so we're never going to focus on that and try to figure out what we could do there, right?
Well, psychotic episodes are a real issue in this country, and it's when you have drugs that have been known to cause psychotic episodes,
right.
Like a lot of these SSRIs, when they mix them with other things like cocaine or whatever,
right.
They've been known to cause these episodes. And then, you know, there's also the issue of parenting. What the fuck kind of horrific environment did this poor kid grow up in that turned him into this monster? I mean, you know, a lot of people don't like someone saying poor kid when it comes to a mass murderer, but as a father, I know that every fucking human being that was walking around today used to be a baby. That's how I see them. You know, what the fuck happened that turned a cute little baby into a monster?
Some people are just bad, I think. Like, and I know it sounds like a really cheap answer, but I think sometimes with mental illness, like, the meds do, I think, fuck a lot of people up. But I think there's also the odds if you didn't medicate them, like, how many people have gone on tremendous sprees because they weren't medicated? It's like, it's almost like you're damned if you, I hate to say that, but... you're right. Aunt Jim almost made a point. They wanted to put me on Ritalin when I was a kid.
Really?
Yeah, my mother said no. Look, he's on Viagra.
If your mother said yes, we would have lost a comedian probably.
Look,
yes.
A fucking loon.
Or you would have gained a man who could keep an erection in a relationship and wouldn't need comedy.
Really? You would probably have a harder time. I mean, doesn't those meds like kill boners?
Oh, they probably do, yeah.
Sure.
But then again, they would have given self-esteem, which is my biggest erection killer.
I don't think it would give you self-esteem. I think they give you a numbness.
Oh, really?
I think what they're doing is they mask the pain that a lot of people experience. You know, I don't know. I'm talking out of my ass because I haven't had him. And I'm not. But there's a lot of issues. It's not nearly as simple as everybody wants to say. Like, all these fucking liberals just running around. Gun control. Look, there's a lot of people with guns that aren't doing this. That's not the issue.
It's not the answer either. It truly isn't.
I want to stay on the drug thing for two more seconds. My mom has been on a shitload of drugs my entire life. A couple things happened. When she went on a new drug, sometimes the look in her face was downright frightening.
Really?
And scary. And then there was the other part of it where she obviously has mental issues, and I went to a lot of these appointments with her, and I watched the psychiatrist just write script after script because he doesn't know what the fuck to do. So I actually have heard guys go, I don't know, try this, and just hand them out like they're fucking playing cards.
Yeah, well, it's a real inexact science, and I have a good friend that was on a bunch of different ones before they found one that worked for him.
Right.
Yeah, but this.
Yeah, they just try it until something might stick.
Thing, yeah.
In my mom's case, she pretty much slept a decade.
Jesus.
She slept a decade. She didn't. Who knows? But
sounds
if it's
relaxing though.
If it's someone else, you're on the wrong combination of shit. Who knows what you're capable of doing?
Yeah, it's the inexact.
Kind of agree with Joe.
The inexact nature of it is really scary, and the long term repercussions of it are really scary. And also, by the way. If the fucking something goes wrong and you can't get your shit for a couple months, you're probably going to go crazy.
Yeah.
Imagine that, Joe, like some type of real catastrophe in this country where the drugs can't make their way to the people that need them and just an entire nation of people off their meds.
Oh.
Holy psychotic episode.
Holy fuck. Yeah. That's a zombie invasion.
just another thing to look at as far as this whole school shooting goes.
Have you ever looked at just how many people need Ambien to go to sleep?
Yes.
Oh, they hand that out like it's
Tic Tacs. 39 million people in this country.
Is it really?
That are regular users of Ambien.
Wouldn't that be over a tenth of our nation?
Yep.
What do we got, about 330 million?
You know, I have a story that I've been telling on stage. It's a true story. When I was in San Francisco, I think it was about a year and a half ago, I was involved in a fire. It turned out to not be a fire. It turned out to be these assholes just blew off fire extinguishers. But it was 4:30 in the morning, and we got woken up to an alarm, like saying that the hotel was on fire. And I had to, run out of there. And as I was hitting the hallway, I run into all these sleepy people that are trying to make their way downstairs. And you'd be fucking amazed at how many of these people were clearly on some kind of
holy jack.
Fucking zombies, because there's hundreds of people in this hotel. They're all cramming into a single-file staircase to slowly. And people were literally waking up as they were on the staircase, not like holding on to the rails going, what's going on? Where are we? What are we doing? Like, didn't know what the fuck was happening while it was happening.
Now, I've changed my opinion. I think having a lot of these people medicated is a good thing.
Dude, it's just, you're right. We're kind of changing the psyche of the country with prescription drugs.
Yeah.
And there's obviously too many people using them that probably really don't need them.
And just like guns, that's not going to stop anytime soon. There are drugstores going up on every corner.
Yeah,
in Manhattan.
It's definitely an issue, and the root of that, mental health, is obviously an issue too.
Yeah.
A lot of people, their lives are shit. They hate their lives. They hate their existence. They hate their job. They hate their wife. They hate where they live. They hate everything, and they're numbing themselves with medication.
Mm-hmm.
And, we got a real problem in this country in that respect. There's a lot of disenfranchised motherfuckers that are running around essentially crazy.
I just figured out in my head quickly. I live in Manhattan. Within two blocks, there's five drugstores.
Yeah.
No pharmaceutical joke. Industry is amazingly wealthy.
But you know what? On the flip side, it's helped a lot of people. The medication has kept a lot of people alive. There's a lot of people. I have friends that have gotten on these antidepressants, and it's saved their life.
And they helped them out. You see a change, right?
Yeah, they were suicidal. A good buddy of mine was telling me he was suicidal. I got him to a psychiatrist. The psychiatrist got him on drugs, and now he's the happiest motherfucker alive. It's a weird thing, because I don't think there's any one correct answer for the entire population. It's just we're doing a lot of experimental shit, and
trying to figure it out.
Yeah, and in doing so, it's really dangerous. We know for a fact that the Columbine killers were on antidepressants. They know for a fact they were doing that, and they were also doing drugs on top of it, which causes psychotic episodes. The truth hasn't come out about this kid. I don't even want to say his fucking name. Yeah. I appreciate that you guys haven't been saying his name. But whatever made this monster, whatever turned this baby into a 20-year-old person that's capable of doing something like that, it's a real societal issue, and it's not going to be fixed by guns being not available. Right. Because, it would have made it a lot harder, but the same day, a fucking guy in China ran into a school and stabbed 20 kids.
Yeah.
And, yes, those kids lived. Yes, those kids are alive because he didn't have the same access to guns. That's a real argument, too. But I have guns. I wouldn't do that.
The fact that somebody would actually run into a school and stab people is the issue. It's the problem.
How the fuck does anybody turn into that person? That's the real issue.
I would love to disagree with you and Anthony on the gun thing, but I really think you guys are right. I really do.
Look, if we had Navy SEALs armed outside that school, just standing there, waving everybody in, none of this would have ever happened.
Right.
And that's reality. I'm not saying that we need fucking armed guards everywhere, because, then you're also leaving things up to the judgment of other human beings, and they can be fucking wackadoos, too. Who knows?
Yeah, we're just going to blindly trust those people. It's really a complicated issue.
It's but very complicated.
But we do have armed guards at Walmart, so thank God. Thank God.
Yeah, but how motivated are they to stay alive? They might just fucking rush right into the bullets.
One of our regulars, Matt in Connecticut, says you have a good take on autism and Asperger's.
Well, it's Well, I don't necessarily know if I have a good take on it, but I think that there's a bunch of factors when it comes to that stuff as well, you know, and one of them might be that it's the next stage of human evolution. I mean, we're looking at human beings the way they are now as if this is the only way, this is the way people are going to be forever, and that's crazy. I mean, we know that we used to be different. We know that we used to be lower hominids, and there's a bunch of whole theories of how, you know, our brain doubled over a period of 2 million years. But if you look at all these environmental factors and you looked at these really strange aberrations in human behavior and abilities and try to figure out what the fuck is going on, one of the possibilities might be that we're watching these changes in human beings that actually led to us being human in the first place. Like when a kid can look out a window and see an entire skyline and then draw it exactly off of memory, what the fuck is going on there? And then when you find out that kid has Asperger's, or I don't even think they're using the term Asperger's anymore. I think it's autism spectrum. I think there's like some, amongst some circles.
Yeah, they say you're on the spectrum. That kid is on the spectrum.
Is that a politically correct term or just more accurate?
Probably.
I am not going to sit here and have you tell me Bobo is further evolved than all of us.
Yeah, exactly.
I think what we're dealing with is subtle changes in the way the human mind works. I mean, when some kid can be like 9 years old and compose 100 symphonies before his 10th birthday, you got to go, what the fuck is happening here? This kid can't even talk to strangers. He can't have a conversation with people. He can't look you in the eye, but yet he's got these incredible abilities. And a lot of people are also thinking that it's a move away from emotions, that the emotions that have led us to have these, like a lot of what gives us emotions, or a lot of the reasons why we have emotions, is so that we have this sense of unity and community, and we feel for each other, and we want to be connected to each other, and all these different things that are a part of human culture. Well, as we like get more and more into technology and separate from people more and more, the argument is that we're slowly going to remove the need for emotions. We're slowly going to remove the need for being human. When we start getting into symbiotic relationships with computers and with technology, the point where people are talking about, you know, having neural interfaces where you have a chip in your fucking brain that's going to allow you to get information directly from Wi-Fi, no computer necessary. How long before you stop being a person? Well, what happens in there where you become some new organism that doesn't have the same sort of emotions that have led us to have these tribal relationships?
I've actually been saying that for a while about sense of humor. Like, I think X amount of, I also think that the idea of country and individuality will someday be seen as primitive qualities. Like, a sense of humor most people have because you need it. It serves a need. It gets you love or gets you approval.
Yeah.
But eventually you'll get those things. Once we know chemically and have mapped DNA and 500 years from now, when all that stuff is just A plus B equals C, there will be no need to get those things. So a sense of humor won't be a needed thing.
Man.
Just like full body hair is no longer a needed thing, or a fucking tail is no longer a needed thing.
Well, no one told Joe Rogan that.
But yes, that's true.
He's the last one with body hair.
Joe's a weird combination of a modern day brain with fucking knuckles from 200,000 BC.
Well, that was my problem as a young boy. I was too much Neanderthal.
Yeah.
Everybody's got the one thing that makes them not fit in. I'm too much monkey.
But I totally agree with you. That's eventually going to go away. Not that we're going to... I don't even think it's a bad thing. I just think that the need that it suffices will be taken care of either by genetic engineering or by just weeding out all those the qualities that make us insecure. And eventually we just won't need that shit, and we'll be focused on other things.
I think you're right, and I think you're absolutely right about a sense of humor. I mean, essentially what you and I do for a living is because human interaction is so fucked up, because we both grew up insecure or whatever the fuck, you know, I mean, all of you guys, everyone on this show, you're... The whole reason you have a job is because there's this issue in society where people can't speak freely. So you guys have these voices, and people are in the car, they go, fuck yeah, they're right. What the fuck is going on? And they don't get these kind of conversations anywhere else because of this imbalance in society. And one day that won't exist anymore. anymore. When we can all read each other's minds, how much humor will exist? I mean, when you know what people are doing long before they do it, these are all like real possibilities of as far as like the future of human interaction. It's like we might be like a fucking appendix of the mind, something that's no longer necessary one day.
Yeah.
Hey, Joe. I need your take on Alex Jones because I know you're a fan of his and I personally feel like I like 15 to 20% of what he says and I think the problem is the 80%. It makes him look like a whack job.
Yeah, well you're right. Yeah, it's about that.
okay, because
Alex is a friend of mine. Like, I was just in Austin, Texas. I hung out with him.
Right.
He allegedly smoked pot with me. He's a fucking good dude when you're just hanging out with him. The problem is he's crazy doom and gloom on that show.
Yes.
That's his business, and everybody that's calling up is like fucking talking about everything's a false flag. He sees conspiracies around every corner.
Everything.
Nothing can just happen. Everything's got to be a conspiracy. But that said, the motherfucker uncovers a lot of shit that turns out to be real.
Right.
There's a lot of things that he was talking about. I met Alex in the 90s, and there was a lot of things that he was talking about back then. I was like, this guy's out of his fucking mind. And then Freedom of Information Act results come out, and it turns out that he was right about false flag events. He was right about Operation Northwoods. He was right about the government faking the war, the Gulf of Tonkin incident, in order to get us into the war of Vietnam. He's right about a lot of shit. He was right about the government trying to engineer a false flag attack to get us into a war in Iran before the end of the Bush administration. This has all been proven that Dick Cheney had these ideas, and they were tossing them around. He's right about a lot of shit, unfortunately. He's got a video called 911, The Road to Tyranny, I think it's called, and it's all about the World Trade Organization, the WTO in Seattle, and how the government sent in military people, like undercover military guys, to pretend to be protesters. The protests were all peaceful, so they send in these paid anarchists to break windows and light cars on fire and shit, so they can come in and physically shut down all of the protests, including the peaceful protests. Oh. And he breaks it down with news reports, with like real facts, and it's really fucking crazy when you watch it. Like, as nutty as he is about a lot of shit, he's right about a lot of shit too. And when you live in that world all day like he does, you start seeing boogeymen around every corner. But around some corner, they are a boogeyman.
You know what? You're right. It's almost like because he cries wolf a lot, but there are times where he's accurate. Like for him, he'll say so many things like he never sees the truth in things. He sees conspiracy all the time when he shouldn't, and when he says stuff, I hear nonsense all the time when I shouldn't. Like
right.
The truth is, the truth is somewhere in the middle, but I caught myself because I'm not a douche.
Well, his latest video, he doesn't think Obama cried. What do you think about that?
How could you not cry? The guy's
Thank you.
Kids,
Thank you.
Know? I think Obama is probably privy to some pretty fucking horrific information about what's going on overseas. Just the fact that he's aware of these drone attacks. And look, people, I absolutely think that what happened in Connecticut is a horrific, horrific thing. But someone had a really good point on Twitter. They wrote, 27 people die in Connecticut, 20 children die in Connecticut, and everyone cries, 20 children die in drone attacks, crickets.
Mm-hmm.
And that's true, man. We are sending flying robots to other countries and launching missiles from them, and thousands of innocent people have died from these. It's in the thousands now. It's scary fucking shit, man. It's really scary shit. And this guy, Obama, he's aware of that stuff. He's aware of what's going on. He must look, that guy's hair is not getting gray because he's getting good rest and a lot of vitamins. he must be seeing some crazy shit.
He really is aging like a Star Trek episode.
It's unbelievable.
I think he's aged more than any other president in recent memory. It's kind of creepy to see.
Well, I think he has more intelligence than Bush, so his detachment is probably lower. So his, his absorbing of what the reality really is probably, motherfucker probably never sleeps. They probably got him on all kinds of.
Need some Ambien.
Yeah, he's probably, Who knows what the fuck he's on just to try to stay awake.
He's probably also more of an idealistic guy, I think. Like, I believe some of his idealism when he went into office. I mean, look, all politicians are full of shit on some level, but I really did think that there was a bit more of an honest because he hadn't been in the game nearly as long as most of the guys that run. Like, he hadn't been a seasoned politician as long as most of them. And I think some of the things he really thought he could change. And now that he's there and he realizes I am not much more, if at all, more transparent than the last guy or the next guy. Mm. Like, when you realize, like, Jesus, I meant what I said, and here I am doing the same shit. That has to bother you on some level, too.
Why would he want to be reelected, then?
Tough gig.
He probably feels like he can change things.
Sure.
He's there, and if he wasn't there, and you get some other robot dude is just going to listen to the military-industrial complex that Eisenhower was warning us about, then shit could get really out of hand. I mean, who the fuck knows? I mean, there's a reason why the guy hasn't closed down Guantanamo Bay. I mean, what is that? Is it because he knows something that we don't know? Is it because he has access to information that shows that, you know, who knows what led him to not do the things that he promised? I mean, who knows what happens when you get in office, like that old Bill Hicks joke about the room full of smoky industrialists where they show you an angle of the Kennedy assassination that no one's ever seen before.
Hey, I'm hearing you got to go, Joe.
Really?
Oh, good. All right. Erock's telling me you got to go. We certainly don't want you.
Erock, why are you saying that?
Erock, what's the problem?
His publicist said he's already over. He has other...
what are you promoting, Joe? We didn't know what you're promoting.
Yeah.
Jesus. I got a new special that's out now, today.
Nice.
It's a new comedy special that's available on joerogan.net. I released it Louis C.K. style on the
nice.
Internet.
Nice. Good for you.
Bucks. Yeah, that's, I think, the future of doing specials. You know, I think a lot of guys are doing that now.
That's great.
And it seems to me like the best way for me to do it. So
you're going to make a shitload
that's
of money.
That's smart, dude. That's a new model, man.
Wow.
It's taking power from the networks. Everyone's online. JoeRogan.net. What's the name of the special?
Live from the Tabernacle Theater in Atlanta.
That's great,
where,
dude.
There where I filmed it. And I think, you know, Louis C.K. did an amazing thing. He's a real trendsetter in this sense, and he's a, you know, he really opened up a lot of people's eyes. So like, yeah, well, why would you put this shit on Comedy Central and get no return, get no money from the DVD sales? And it makes it easier. It's cheaper for $5. It's like it's a really reasonable rate, I think.
Yeah, Comedy Central did it to themselves.
Yeah, they did.
They really needed to figure that stuff out before you guys did.
Well,
good
I think
for you guys, man.
All networks, it's like, you know, eventually they fuck up.
Well, I'll absolutely be downloading this. I love pretty much everything you do, Joe. I'm a big fan of the podcast, which is just taking over the world. It's
the
go-to podcast.
It wouldn't exist if I had never come on your show, and that is an absolute 100% fact. If I had never realized how fun it was to just hang out and shoot the shit with friends on the radio, I would have never done it. And then once you
people
guys
love
went
it.
To satellite and I realized how fun it is to do it uncensored,
I would have
never done the podcast if it wasn't for you guys. That's 100%
That's fucking cool.
I just listened to the Don Marrera one, and I really liked it a lot. We never really hit it off with Dom, unfortunately, but we probably should give him another chance.
I love Dom.
Yeah,
he's a great guy.
You guys were great together. I just listened to that the other day. You know, Dom quickly was part of the whole Philly fiasco that Bill Burr blew up.
Oh, right.
And Dom had a bad set that day, too. It was a wild crowd. Jimmy Schubert ate it, then Don Marrera ate it, and Bill Burr was watching this backstage, just
he's
a little
behind-the-scenes
shit, and he's like, fuck that. You know Bill and his issues. He's like, that ain't happening to me, man.
He went out like Maximus stuff.
Boy, did he.
It was a glorious moment.
Are you not entertained?
Right.
fuck you, and fuck the Liberty Bell.
Yeah.
It was fucking brutal, and the fucking fact they had to get like a fucking amazing headliner to close that show out and bring it all home.
Who closed that one?
Who remembers? It's not important. Joe Rogan's special out today. JoeRogan.net. Dude, that's great. I'm happy to see more comics doing that, and I'm fucking, I'm a tremendous fan of your stuff.
Absolutely.
I'm a tremendous fan of all you guys. I love the fuck out of you guys. I think you're the best show ever in the history of radio, and I don't even think there's a close second
Thank
place.
You, Joe.
Wow, Joe.
Thank you, buddy.
Gotta get
My
your
God.
Ass in the studio, man.
I'll be back. It's gonna be a UFC in New Jersey in a couple of months, and I'll come in a day early just to hang with you guys.
Cool, man.
You gotta call us back soon because there's so much more we want to talk about.
I will. Right. I'll call you back next week. Does that sound good?
Yep.
Very cool.
We're off
for a while. Christmas.
All right, how about the week after? We're home.
Okay, week after. Whatever.
All right. Good. All right.
Be good, buddy.
Cool, Joe.
Take care.
Take care, Joe.
Later, man.
That's great. I'm so because Rogan has a big following, and I'm so happy that comedian after comedian is now Aziz did it. Joe's
taking
doing
it back.
Fucking
yes.
Louis, who really changed the fucking game. That redheaded fucking zilch changed
the
game.
Douche would be such an innovator.
Dude, he fucking him and his fucking his weird circle head and his weird circle body has changed the fucking game for comedians. Yeah, yeah. It's amazing what he did. Yeah. Gaffigan did it. It's so great.
It really is.
That these guys with fucking I want to do that someday too.
Yes.
It's special like that. Like, it's encouraging. I can't
not
do it
someday.
Now.
You should do it
now.
Next
I'm not.
Time.
Honestly, I don't have the following of a Louis. I mean, realistically, I don't. And I'm okay with that.
You can make 30, 40 bucks, Jim.
That and you know, from your lips to God's ears.
I know. And of course, Joe Rogan on Twitter there. So
who has JoeRogan.com? Just give it to him.
Oh, he doesn't have that yet.
No, he's got. Oh, maybe he does.
Maybe he does.
I'm yelling, it might be his.
Yeah.
Is he? Let's see. Mm-mm. No.
What is
who
it?
Is that? Is it a realtor? Joe Rogan, the realtor?
Do you know how fucking brutal I would have had people ask him for?
Oh, my God, right?
They'd be asking to buy cocks and dog shit.
The house next door to me was sold to Joe Rogan.
I would fucking just spend $1 million or something, man.
Oh, that's pretty good.
Give a fuck.
This should be an unwritten law. I mean, if you're the most popular Joe Rogan, you should get this shit. The Tom Green situation?
The more popular Joe Rogan,
why
yes.
Why not? You know, put
I don't
your...
I think it's the realtor.
Put your name in the fucking hat, and then someone, you know, the social networking world decides, all right, who is the most popular Joe Rogan? He gets JoeRogan.com, right. Not some dumb real estate guy.
Wouldn't it be funny if the Joe Rogan realtor had 2 million Twitter followers? And actually had a blog about UFC that was bigger than Rogan's? He has a podcast with fucking 4 million listeners just talking about property values.
You know what?
Dull fucking blog that would be.
Oh, yeah. And he'd be saying something about, like, you know, the grass regrowing on Sycamore Street, LOL. It's got like 4 million views. I said 4 million twice. Good improv. Zilch.